We are creating interventional treatments for mental health. Traditionally, we treat depression or anxiety with pills every day, and they kind of just manage the symptoms and not really getting to the underlying cause of disease, and patients end up staying on those for many years. And what we're hoping to do with our treatments is chemically intervene, pharmacologically intervene, to break the negative patterns of thinking and break people's depressive cycles.
But to really understand the significance of this novel work, let's take a step back and start at the beginning. Psychedelics are mind-altering substances that can produce profound changes in perception, thought, and emotion. They don't only change how we perceive the world, they can change how you perceive yourself.
Psychedelics have been around forever, millennia. Indigenous cultures have used them for all kinds of purposes for thousands of years.
The Mazatec people of Mexico, for example, have a rich tradition of using mushrooms in ritualistic purposes. But how come we only heard about them a half a century ago? And how do they get to the US? Well, let me answer that question with another question. What do an American banker, a Russian pediatrician, and a Mexican shaman have to do with John Lennon and the Rolling Stones? So it's the early 1920s, and English major and journalist Gordon Wasson gets a scholarship to go to the London School of Economics. There he meets a Russian medicine student named Valentina Pavlovna and marries her after she becomes a pediatrician. They go on their honeymoon in the Appalachian Mountains and stumble upon some mushrooms while walking around a forest. Valentina wants to eat them. Gordon has his reservations, but they're both fascinated by them. They decide to study fungi and their cultural taboos. Fast forward a couple of decades later, the Wassons travel the world studying fungi, eventually following a trail in 1955 that leads them to Oaxaca, Mexico. There, they meet this woman, a shaman or healer named Maria Cybin. Cybin hesitates, but she agrees to let them participate in an ancient Mazatec ceremony where they take psilocybin mushrooms. It's the first time Westerners ever participated in this ceremony. Rumors have it that John Lennon and Mick Jagger of the Rolling Stones were among those who actually met Cybin.
And then they became popular and were studied a lot in the 60s and 70s, and then that all got shut down, especially psilocybin and LSD. They were associated with the anti-war movement, and the Nixon administration basically closed down research.
By 1968, possession of LSD was already illegal in the US. By 1970, the Comprehensive Drug Abuse Prevention and Control Act classified most psychedelics as Schedule 1 drugs, meaning they have a high potential for abuse and no accepted medical use. Then on June 17, 1971, President Nixon declared the war on drugs. Research for psychedelics was virtually outlawed.
That's a shame because it means we lost several decades.
Early research had already shown psychedelics' potential to treat mental health issues. And mental illness is a global crisis. About 280 million people worldwide have suffered from depression, 300 plus million people from anxiety, and roughly 250 million people suffer from post-traumatic stress disorder. Current treatments only manage symptoms and are often ineffective or come with debilitating side effects. The worst part is that roughly 30% of people diagnosed with major depression don't respond to current treatment, a condition called treatment-resistant depression. And we desperately need some new solutions. And that's where there's some good news, because the tide is finally turning. Thanks to rigorous scientific research and a growing understanding of the brain, psychedelics are finally getting a second chance.
Over the last decade, there's been a renaissance and more interest. Hundreds of studies at many sort of academic institutions like Johns Hopkins, NYU, UCSF, Berkeley, King's College London. So really high-profile institutions generating data, doing small studies and showing that it is potential for these treatments to work.
What made people think that psychedelics could have these positive effects?
Yeah, I think it's somewhat iterative. It's clear to anyone that tries a psychedelic for the first time that after doing so, they have a sense of well-being, a sense of connectedness with the universe, a sort of peace, sometimes more peace with themselves. That sort of iterative understanding turns from well-being to, well, if someone's actually ill, can we go from, you know, ill to better?
The promise of how amazing psychedelics can be for mental health are so good that it almost comes across as pure hype. But from what I've seen, it actually isn't. There have been almost 1,500 articles about psychedelic therapy published since 2020. But how do these psychedelics work, and how are they able to have such amazing benefits? Well, At a molecular level, psychedelics like psilocybin work by activating special receptors in our brains that are usually triggered by serotonin, aka the feel-good hormone. Our brains work by making connections between our neurons or brain cells. When we learn things or acquire new habits, certain connections and patterns form. Every time we repeat those habits, the patterns get stronger. It's like you building more roads that all reach the same destination. Scientists believe that diseases like depression and anxiety are a malfunction of those connections.
I'm going to steal an analogy from Michael Pollan's book, How to Change Your Mind. As a patient is skiing down a hill, and they're skiing down a hill repeatedly, time after time, years, maybe months and years. And as they ski, they create ruts in the snow. And the more they ski, the deeper those ruts become, and the harder it is to get out of them. It's hard to break the negative patterns of thinking. And he describes psychedelics like a fresh fall of snow. So that enables the patient to ski off in a new direction. So it's another way of saying that these treatments appear to enable people to break the negative patterns of thinking and overcome their depression or their anxiety.
Other researchers studied how the brain activates when you take psilocybin. They saw neurons firing like crazy in parts of the frontal cortex. They think that these changes hinder something called top-down processing in the brain. It's a sort of filter that combines outside inputs with our previous knowledge and expectations to show us our unique view of reality. Psychedelics kind of mess with that. Imagine if you're trying to assemble a puzzle. With top-down processing, you would rely heavily on the picture on the box to guide you, focusing on finding pieces that match your expectations. However, under the influence of psilocybin, it's as if the picture on the box becomes less important. You pay more attention to the individual pieces themselves, their color, shape, and textures, allowing new patterns and connections to emerge that you might not have thought about before. And that's why these drugs make us perceive reality so differently. And their effectiveness is off the chart. Cybin is a phase 3 company that has started its Paradigm 550 patient study, and their sector-leading intellectual property portfolio now includes over 70 granted patents and more than 220 patent applications pending. In a recent phase 2 major depression trial, 75% of patients were entered remission after just 2 doses of Cybin's flagship compound, CYB3. But they're not just studying these compounds, they're engineering them. First, they synthesize the compounds to ensure they're 100% pure. CYB3 is made directly with psilocin, which is the active ingredient you get by clipping out this part right here. So it works much faster than natural psilocybin. But they go beyond that with a process called deuteration.
What it involves is substituting selected hydrogen atoms on the molecule with heavy hydrogen, which is called deuterium, so deuteration. And that has the impact of improving the pharmacokinetics, that is, how the molecule gets to the site of action in the brain, but it doesn't change the underlying pharmacology, which is how the molecule works, how it binds to receptors. So we want to keep that part of it, don't want to mess with that, but we wanted to make the molecule more efficient.
Compared to just classic traditional psilocybin, what would be the benefits of doing it this way?
We see fast onset, so about 15 minutes, which is pretty quick. But then we also see an improvement in bioavailability, that's how much of the drug is available, and an increase in brain penetration. So we see about a 40% increase in brain to plasma concentration ratio. So it means it's getting out of the peripheral circulation and into the brain very efficiently. So that means we can give lower doses.
So at a very high level, from ingestion to the whole the process, like, could you explain how it actually works?
Our CYB3 molecule binds to serotonin receptors, and so receptors on the brain cells. And then that appears to cause quite an immense amount of neuroplasticity, which is just a fancy word for new connections and networks being created in the brain. Parts of the brain talking to each other that don't usually do so. But the downstream effects between receptor binding and neuroplasticity, we don't know what that mechanism is yet. And that's not that unusual in drug development, but we're learning more every week and every month.
Can you just walk me through the entire process of that day?
Yeah, so when patients come in, the first thing we do is we educate them. So most of these patients are psychedelic naive, have never tried psychedelics before. So you don't want someone going to an experience like this without some education, without some tools, and so they know how to deal with things if they get a little bit anxious. For the treatment itself, they're in a very comfortable space, cushions, blankets, soft space. And then we have them put on an eye mask and wear a headset, and there's a curated playlist. And the idea behind that is to cut out all external distractions. And then the patient spends their time going inwardly, focusing on their condition and focus on the goals that have been set with their facilitator beforehand. And that lasts 4 to 6 hours or so. And then the next day they come back and talk to their facilitator and kind of unpack what they experienced. And sometimes it takes a little while, a few sessions or a few days, but we see really dramatic changes. In fact, one thing we know is that patients who have good experiences with psychedelics are great advocates, because when they have that transformative experience, they just can't stop talking about it.
And if you're thinking that this is all highly clinical and supervised because it's somehow unsafe, that couldn't be further from the truth. Based on my research, here's a list of different drugs and their safety. As you can see, mushrooms are about as safe as it gets. So then that's where we stand in the beginning stages of a renaissance. But there's still challenges ahead. First, there's regulation. Psilocybin research has been decriminalized in many states, but it's still not legal in every state, only in Oregon and Colorado. And the results of our recent elections might also fast-track the research of novel psychedelics, with Robert Kennedy Jr. saying the FDA's war on public health is about to end, including its aggressive suppression of psychedelics. Elon Musk has also shown his support for psychedelics and their research. But one thing I liked about Cybin is that they're working directly with the FDA to design their phase 3 clinical trials, fast-tracking approvals for therapeutic use. That means that they're likely to get a license long before general legalization ever reaches policymakers' ears. And then there's the general fear of perception. Many people, myself included, were told a lot of bad and ultimately wrong things about psychedelics. But as people start to see the results published from Cybin's phase 2 trials, that's going to be a complete game changer. Imagine a world where mental health is no longer a life sentence, where people can break free from the chains of addiction, where trauma can be healed, and where creativity and well-being flourish. And I get pretty pumped up just thinking about it. Who doesn't know someone who has struggled with depression or anxiety or drug addiction? I love a world where people get a chance to further research and develop more and more things. And for far too long, research into psychedelics was banned, and that's probably set us back a generation. But it's not too late. And companies like Cybin are on the forefront of pushing clinical trials. This is not some distant thing. It's happening now. So what's next? Well, Cybin is starting its phase 3 multinational clinical trial paradigm program now in 36 clinical sites across the US and Europe. There might never be a more exciting time to be alive to see this renaissance of mental health problem solving as the one we find ourselves in right now. But what do you think? Do you know people who would benefit from some of the clinical trials that Cybin is running right now? And what's your general take about psychedelics and their mental health benefits? I'd love to know. Sound off in the comments below. And if you have any questions, we'll try to reach out to the team and get them answered in the comments below. Thank you so much for watching. We'll catch you guys next week.